Hello again, everyone, and welcome back to Bloodborne. I've got quite a bit to discuss today, but before we launch right into that, I'm going to get a little bit of NPC dialogue out of the way.
Oh, there you are. Forgive me, I'm a bit out of sorts. So, no blood today, I'm afraid.
Interesting. So now that the blood moon is out, everybody in the chapel is going super nuts! They have completely and utterly lost it at this point. So apparently, not only does the moon turn people into beasts, but it also causes them to go insane. Interesting indeed. Alright. We are going to spend today's episode going through the Upper Cathedral Ward, and I should forewarn everybody that, after my usual fashion, I took it very slowly going through that area, because in spite of the fact that, thanks to the Chalice Dungeons, I'm now ridiculously overleveled for this part of the game, even still, the Upper Cathedral Ward is no joke. It's a pretty dangerous area, and it's still very easy to get killed if you're careless, which I was. Starting with this, I am amazed I made it through that completely unscathed. It didn't occur to me until later that I could have just gone the opposite way around the tower. I could have gone clockwise rather than counterclockwise and been fine and avoided all of those enemies. But unfortunately, I recorded this fairly late at night after arriving home from work, so the gameplay aspect of it, not great, not my best. However, I am recording this commentary nice and fresh this morning after having gotten up and had some semblance of breakfast, so hopefully the commentary will make up for the lack of skilled or remotely decent gameplay. I'd like to get to a couple of questions and comments straight away, and I am going to be pausing periodically to point out different elements of the environment. One of the first elements that I'd like to point out is the fact that the entire Cathedral Ward is interconnected in a really believable way. We climbed the Healing Church workshop, the tower, from the Uden Chapel. And that brought us here to the Cathedral Ward, where we can now see that we are standing very close to the clock tower that we'd been able to view at a much greater distance from much earlier points in the game. In addition to which, there are these, I don't know, some people would call them cute. I personally find them a little bit disconcerting. These, I forget what we even called them. I forget their official name, but they're kind of gross. This gate, also, I had wanted to mention it. I think I remembered. Yeah, I did. You can't open this or get through here ever at any point. It's meant to make the area look bigger than it is, but in actual fact, if you were to somehow miraculously clip through that gate, you would find that you'd fall through the ground on the other side very quickly. So there is nothing over there. Another thing I'd like to take a moment to appreciate, and I don't remember if I did it now, at some point soon, I think, I panned the camera up to look at the building we're about to head into. No, it's not now. Now is a very dumb, careless, and unlucky death. Like I said, this area does not mess around. The enemies up here are pretty powerful, even considering my levels and the equipment that I now have, which I guess really amounts to the weapon upgrades. Weapon upgrades in this game make a very big difference, maybe a little bit more so than they have in past games. And somebody mentioned that in the comments of the previous episode when I was talking about how much difference levels make. They said that weapons make a very big difference as well, and I agree, they absolutely do. I think it was right here. Oh no, well, it was soon, but at some point I'm going to pan up to the building up ahead, which is the orphanage. It's where the choir is based. And it's entirely possible to play through the game without ever coming to the Upper Cathedral Ward, because it's non-essential. You can beat the game without ever getting anything here. But there is some fairly nice stuff here, and some very interesting enemies and bosses. I was trying to sneak up on these guys, and then I remembered that I had pebbles, and I could lure them one at a time. And I thought, oh wait, what the hell am I even doing? I can make this way easier. I also, I think at the same time I panned up to the building, I panned down off the bridge so that we can see we are now directly above the path leading to the Grand Cathedral. And then on the other side of the bridge, on the left, we can see directly down to the circular plaza behind the gate opened by the Hunter Chief Emblem. I think it's after I beat these enemies I showed it. But now that I've explained what's going to be happening in the video, let me get to a couple of questions. Before anything else, I had started to answer a question yesterday about my gaming experience before finding the Souls series, and I ended up not having enough time to properly answer that at the end of the episode. Yeah, it's here. You can see down there to the stairs leading up to the Grand Cathedral, and then on the other side, the plaza leading up to the stairs. But I got to talk a little bit about my experience growing up in the United States in the small town where I lived for, I think it was about 14 years. Moved to the States with my parents when I was around 4. That was 1989. And that was when things were really kind of starting to fall apart in the East Bloc. All of the stuff with Reagan and Gorbachev was going on, and the Soviets were gradually opening their policies and all of that stuff. The whole tear down this wall speech by Reagan happened around that time, and things were just getting really chaotic in the East Bloc, and it was an increasingly challenging and in some ways dangerous place to live. So we ended up moving to the States, long story short. But then as a kid growing up in the States, my parents needed some place to leave me while they were working and trying to support us. So they left me with a local babysitter who was a wonderful, wonderful woman. I loved her to death. Her son was my best friend for years and years growing up. And as I mentioned in the previous episode, there were a number of other kids she took care of who also shared great interest in video games. Her husband owned an NES, and he loved playing Dragon Warrior and the very first Legend of Zelda game. And that was how I learned to appreciate those games growing up. And at some point, somewhere fairly early on, I was 7 or 8, I was with my parents at a tag sale somewhere, and I managed to convince them to pick up an NES cartridge of Final Fantasy, the original Final Fantasy 1. And I brought that to my babysitter's house and ended up playing that with my friends there as well. And they had some other games. They had the Super Mario Brothers Duck Hunt combination cartridge. They had, we ended up, I don't even remember where we got them, but we ended up picking up some of the Mega Man games after not that long. I was really surprised, even as a kid, I was very surprised that any adults enjoyed playing video games at all. But my babysitter's husband really loved it, and then of course all the kids loved it. So we got quite a bit of exposure to it there, and that was really my first opportunity to play video games. That was when I was first introduced to them and first really learned to appreciate them, started finding out about what they were. At that early age, I didn't really understand that the games I was playing came from a country halfway across the world with a completely different society and completely different views. This ambush, by the way, I knew it was coming, was trying to do something, anything, to counter it. But in the process of trying to do that, I ended up just putting myself in a terrible position and, well, yeah. Sometimes the best laid plans of mice and men. I forget the rest of that quote, but something about them going awry. Interesting book. I don't know that I would read it again. I was forced to read it in one of my high school English classes. But in any case, my exposure to video games really happened after coming to the United States. We didn't have video games in the East Bloc. And even if we had, my parents... I'm not sure if this is something I've even talked about before, but my parents were the sorts of people in the 80s who were of the opinion that video games were the devil. They sort of had the same view of video games that their parents' generation did of comic books. Granted, I don't think that attitude was particularly prevalent in the East Bloc, but I know it was much more so in the United States. And their parents, particularly, didn't have access to comic books, or they didn't have access to comic books when they were growing up in the old country. The old countries, I should say. They're from two completely different countries. But in either case, they didn't have comic books for their parents to criticize them about. So they didn't really have that kind of empathy for me as a kid. And they were of the school of thought of many contemporary parents in the 80s at that time in the United States, where they thought that video games and all of that crazy stuff coming out of Japan that was unfamiliar to them, they were afraid of it because they didn't understand it. And they thought that their kids were getting addicted to it, and that there was some crazy, terrible reason why they should absolutely forbid their kids from playing video games. So I never got to have video games at home. My only opportunity to play them was at my babysitter's house. And later on, when I was a little older, there were a couple of other places where I was exposed to it. And I was browsing YouTube a while ago, not that long ago, a few weeks, I think. And I don't even remember how. This is just one of those things where I end up on a How It's Made marathon or watching other random crazy videos, and occasionally I'll leave a comment and then I'll get a response on a How It's Made video saying, "Spy, I never expected to run into you here." You know, I have varied interests and a wide range of things that I like to watch during what little spare time I have, but I came across a news broadcast. It was clearly taped from a VCR in the mid to late 80s, a news broadcast talking about the new video games that were coming out of Japan, which at that time was the SNES, I think, had just come out. And it's hilarious watching all of the 1980s Americans with their ridiculous, poofy, 3-foot-tall beehive hairdos and terrible clothes and just all, I can't believe I'm a child of that generation. It's just bloody humiliating. And this news broadcast, they're talking about kids being brought to clinical support groups for video game addiction because it's the fashionable thing to do. And then you see this one mother who clearly has never worked a day in her life. She's this obviously looking at her, the stay-at-home mom who takes care of the kids all the time, and her husband's a businessman who earns a high-paying job. And somebody in the comments even said of her that she probably has 70 pairs of shoes in her closet. What's she to talk about not letting her kid play video games? I'll link it in the description if I can find it again. It was just hilarious and also quite sad. I had wanted to take an opportunity here as well to point out that although it took me forever to get the right angle to do it, you can make this encounter easier on yourself by pulling the beast down below in the corner. And I'm about to show here as well, I'll say it now so that I can get back to my story. You can cheese the beasts hanging on the chandelier here when they fall down by attacking them through the railing. For some reason, even after the patches that have been implemented so far, and this is as of 1.03, so if anybody watching, anyone from FromSoft is watching this and sees it, they might actually fix it in the future. No, they won't. Who am I kidding? But the AI of these enemies, and maybe it's just something in the entire game, because a lot of other enemies will do this as well. I think maybe it's intentional. They'll stand there and prioritize trying to hit you through walls rather than pathing around the walls to hit you. And given that they seem to do it very purposefully, I think it was an intentional element of the AI design, or else an element that maybe wasn't intentional, but they just looked at and said, eh, fuck it, let's leave it. Players love doing that to enemies, let's let enemies now do that to players. But so I'll put this, I'll link in the description this old news broadcast if I can find it. It's funny watching it, but I kind of think that if you're one of my viewers who is not actually from the United States or has not lived there for some significant period of time during the 1980s, the irony might be a little bit more difficult to appreciate. But my parents were very much a part of that school of thought. And as a result, they forbade me from having any video game consoles or peripherals of any kind at home when I was a kid. I had to do all kinds of sneaky things to get to play video games. There is a very amusing irony, though, because when I was 12, when my parents decided that I was old enough to not have to go with them everywhere that they went during my summer vacations when school was out, their first thought was that, hey, we'd better find something for Franz to do over the summer so that he doesn't find a way to play video games for 2.5 months. So completely unbeknownst to me, without even so much as having the common decency to warn me in advance, they enrolled me as a volunteer at a program a few towns over, a treatment program for children and young adults on the autism spectrum. And it was basically their way of saying, well, guess what? You're not going to have the summer to do whatever the hell you want. You're going to go do something productive and be a useful member of society. And we'll be damned if we're going to see you sit indoors all summer playing video games. And the irony was, I get to this place, and I get introduced to the staff, I get introduced to some of the other kids, and being 12, you know, I was the very youngest of their volunteers. I guess the idea was that I was supposed to be some form of role model for them. And I don't know why on earth they chose me for that purpose. I was not really the greatest role model as a kid. But what ended up happening was that this place, unbeknownst to my parents, and they didn't bother even doing enough research on it beforehand to have found this out, this place had 5 or 6 different video game consoles that they used with the kids during their free time. So my parents, in their desperate quest to prevent me from spending the summer playing video games, inadvertently forced me to volunteer at a place where I spent the majority of my time playing video games. And it ended up working out for me in the end, because a lot of the kids there were incredibly intelligent, very much on my level in terms of interest in video games. They loved video games. And a lot of them were better at video games than I was, and much more intimately familiar with them. So I learned a great deal from them, and that's another important part of my background with video games. It's, I would go so far as to say, probably one of the most important influences, actually, because a number of those kids were into really eclectic, obscure series and genres that I had never heard of at that point. That's where I was introduced to the Super Smash Bros. Series, which hadn't been out for that long. They had a Nintendo 64 there, and Smash was one of the very favorite games for the kids to play. They liked a lot of the older NES and SNES games as well. Nintendo's consoles tended to be quite prevalent there because the program directors preferred to avoid exposing the kids to any more violence in video games than they could possibly avoid. And Nintendo's titles at that time tended to be pretty tame. I would say Smash probably was the least tame of all of them. But I also got to play games there like Ocarina of Time, Star Fox, Metroid. I really got a lot of exposure to games that we all take for granted and that everybody knows about now, but that I probably would never have had a chance to play had I not been able to spend time there and play them away from my parents. It was a fascinating experience, and I made a lot of friends. They really were very nice kids, very well-intentioned, terrible social skills, but then my social skills were shit at the time too, so maybe it was just as well that I ended up there. I got my basic education kind of crash course in video games over the following 6 years I spent volunteering there. I, at first, was very upset with my parents for having volunteered me without my consent. But when I realized what was really going on and what the benefits were and the fact that they had no idea that I was spending so much time playing video games with other kids who loved video games as well, I was like, you know what? I don't think I'm going to tell them. I'm going to let on that I hate it and it's terrible, because surely if I'm not having any fun, that must mean I'm not playing video games, right? And then that will make them enroll me again next year, and I'll continue pretending that I hate it, and then they will enroll me again the year afterward. And lo and behold, single-minded and predictable as my parents were, much though I love them, it worked like a charm. They sent me back every year after that. And every year after that, I spent the majority of my time hanging out with my friends there on the spectrum and my fellow volunteers, because there were a number of other volunteers around my age that also loved video games. And the staff there were really great. They were, many of them were several years older, but also of the same mind. And it was really great for the years that I volunteered there. And my parents never found out until much later, when years and years afterward, well into college for me, I mentioned it to them in passing. I was like, oh, you know, by the way, Mom and Dad, you know that place you sent me to volunteer as a kid where I was supposed to not be playing video games? Well, guess what? And they were furious. But then when they calmed down, they were like, you know what? You should just live your life and do what you want to do. I was like, thanks, Mom and Dad. I'm glad you finally understand. So that's my origin story, as it were. At least as far as video games. I have to just touch upon the fact here that I really, really, really hate brain suckers. They're bastards. Granted, I did not really handle this encounter in the very smartest of ways. But still, this is just humiliating. But I have to acknowledge it because it's happening, and here I am talking about how I learned to love video games. Meanwhile, being terrible at video games on camera. What can I say? We all have our off days. Getting back to comments here, though. Let's see, what do I have left? Oh, I did actually want to address this because a number of people had chipped in their theories and ideas on whatever ended up happening to Alfred in the previous episode. And the one that I like most, and the one that I most want to believe, as I make contact here, this guy, what is the possible backstory? I don't even care about how Alfred died. I want to know what happened to that dude. But, yeah, the best theory and the one that I like most was proffered by my buddy Northern Dragon, who suggested that Alfred killed himself by just standing there like everybody else in the Hunter's Dream, all of those specters that you see, and using the buff of Logarius's wheel. That's what I want to believe. I'd like to think that he just stood in front of the altar. I really think that in the next patch, they should just add a developer specter next to Alfred's corpse, of just him standing there spamming L2 with the transformed Lugarius's wheel, and then just falling over dead. That's what I want to think. But we'll never know, I guess. Another person asked me, and I would like to get to some travel-related questions as well. Somebody had asked, how is the public transportation in Berlin? And can you get by in Berlin using just English? As far as English, and this is true for most other big cities in Europe, I would say. It varies a little bit from country to country. But because Europe is such a melting pot, and because there's a lot of cultural diffusion, English is a de facto very common language here. So if you go to Berlin, or Paris, or, I mean, London, obviously, because it's actually the official language in London, but, any of the other non-English-speaking countries in Europe, at least the Western parts of Europe, chances are enough people and enough organizations will have some level of friendliness toward English. Most people will, or many people anyway, will speak it. That you should be okay getting by. But again, it's always better to have some grasp on the native language wherever you are. It'll just make things easier in general. Also, this boss, I forgot about these guys when I said that the Witch of Hemwick was the easiest boss in the game. I would venture to suggest that these guys probably are. You can tell which one is the real boss by the fact that it does not attack you, it will just stand there. And the reason it doesn't attack you is quite simply because if it did, you could just riposte it to death and kill it in a couple of hits. I wanted to see if Shaman Bone Blades would work on these guys. Every now and then, if you hit only the boss with one, the others will turn on it, but it's hard to hit only the boss. Usually you'll end up hitting a bunch of them, and then they'll just attack each other and not do too much to the boss. So, Shaman Bone Blades are kind of a crapshoot for this fight, but I was just messing around. I didn't really take this battle very seriously, so it ended up going a lot worse for me than it would have had I just focused on the boss with charge attacks or something. But, as far as English in Berlin, Berlin is pretty friendly to English. You can usually get by here with no German, but people will tend to have a better time communicating with you, obviously, if you do have some level of German. So, I don't know. I mean, if you're a tourist from America and you want to see the city, most of the tourist attractions in the city, there are people there who will speak English. So, you should be okay. The public transportation is decent, but in my humble opinion, grossly overpriced. I think I talked about this a little while ago, I believe it was in episode 15 or 16, but right now, for the very basic of the Fahrkarten, which is the public transit tickets, a single ticket, a one-way ride for 2 hours, is €2.70, which is almost $3 American. So that's a pretty expensive fare. Some of my viewers in Central and South America had told me that a bus ticket was something like the equivalent of 70 or 80 cents US in their countries. So, as fares go, here in Germany, or at least in Berlin, it may be different from city to city, but it's quite expensive here. And if you're coming here as a tourist and you plan on using the public transit a lot to get to different parts of the city, generally, you're better off just getting a week pass, especially if you're going to be hopping trains and buses, because those are the two main modes of transit here in Berlin that the tickets are good for. And I had been meaning to put together a video on the public transportation here in Berlin. I actually ended up using some of the footage I recorded for that video to make the channel update back in February, letting everybody know that I was working on the Bloodborne guide. I might still make that video at some point, I don't know. The footage is really kind of crappy. I recorded a lot of it with a stealth camera that just had a horrifically terrible microphone on it, so I don't know. If anyone is actually interested in that, let me know. But for now, thank you all for joining me, and I will see you guys next time.